Well, hey, you caught the weekend that once in a while we let our arts and worship kind of let their hair down. Did you enjoy that first song that they played? I mean, years ago, my wife and I were able to go see the Trans-Siberian Orchestra, and whew, what a whole night of just unbelievable music. So our team works very, very hard, and man, Oh Holy Night, who doesn't like Oh Holy Night? Man, they did a great, great job. But hey, my name is Tom Blount. If you do not know me, I'm one of the pastors here at Heritage Church. I want to thank you personally for taking time out of your busy weekend, and I know these days that we live in are very, very interesting, and you chose to come to Heritage Church this week, and thank you so much. I will go on record to say the first service was on fire. I mean, was on fire. Pastor Tom was preaching hellfire and brimstone. We had a light up here that started smoking. Honest to God, when I first got on stage, I'm like, something's not right. You know, you could smell it, and had actually, a couple leave. They're like, dude, they're looking up there. Smoke's coming out of it. Try to keep the attention of an audience with everybody going. And I had like 20 guys walking the room, making sure you weren't safe. I mean, you were safe because you weren't here. And everybody else, you know, they're like, you know, and they're walking all around the place. And so finally, I just stopped. I'm like, you know what? Hey, can you all just look up here? But thank the Lord it didn't like burst out into a flame, but it was just a plug that kind of melted. So thank you so much for coming out. But you missed a hot service. I mean, really, it was a hot, hot, hot service. But hey, we've been studying in a 3-week series about the joy of Christmas. And I'm here to tell you, seriously, it's been very great. I'll be honest with you. You say, because you spoke? No. The message series that was written, I got a few weeks ago and was looking at it, and I was really excited about it because I know that everybody seriously wants to experience real joy in their life. And I think a lot of times we get it mixed up with really what real joy is. And I want you to understand that what real joy is what we're going to find out about, and I'll kind of recap what we talked about yesterday, but I want to also go publicly and tell you this. Many of you, December 1st, about a week and a half ago, about 2 weeks ago, almost 2 weeks ago, jumped online, got on board, above your tithes and offering, began to give to our new Christmas offering. This is such an amazing thing how we had a lot of fun last year doing it. We saved a lot of money, change for kids, you know, changed, the kids were saving and they gave it. Up to date, right now, you all have given over $8,000 to the Lord in expanding our borders and what we're doing. So I'm very, very thankful. Seriously, thank the Lord for that. It's an awesome thing. You say, why is it so awesome? Well, people here at Heritage Church have been giving generously all throughout the year, online and things of that nature, in the midst of this COVID thing. And we've actually exceeded some of the things we wanted to do, which is crazy. And online services, as Diane said, and things of that nature, but you can actually launch a church, a full-blown church with a pastor in place. Don't ask me how they do it, but the Timothy Initiative has brought new hope to us on how to reach people across the world for $300. Some of you here could probably give $300. Absolutely, you could start a whole church for $300 through the Timothy Initiative. So what we're doing this year is the same thing we did last year. And then we added something locally. People really struggle many times with medical bills. If you give $1, $1 to the Christmas offering, you can actually pay off. Don't ask me how this works. It's a God thing or somebody else is generous behind the scenes. You can pay off somebody's medical bill for $100. If you give a dollar. I mean, honestly, some of us could probably just reach. And so my point is, thank you. I want to tell you, thank you so much for what you're doing. And then tonight, did you catch that? How many people, when they were young, sat down and watched the Charlie Brown Christmas Story? Come on, just be honest. Some of you weren't alive when that was written, but you've already seen it. It's a great thing. You actually, they have worked so hard behind the scenes for weeks. Tonight, 7:00, you don't want to miss it. It's not just for kids. You can sit around in your living room, pop your popcorn, eat it, have a great time with your kids, or if you're just a couple, get online, heritage.com, and watch the Christmas special tonight. It sounds just like, you know, ABC or NBC. You know, we got tonight, 7:00, so you don't want to miss it. So we've been studying a little bit about the joy of Christmas, and I want you to understand, here's the joy of Christmas. The joy of Christmas, what we looked at last week was this. it's also the promise of Christmas. And you say, Pastor Tom, what's the promise of Christmas? Remind me. Here's the thing we need to understand. What we looked at with a few verses from the Word of God is what we understood was the promise of Christmas brings joy. Because here's what people do. They'd say, well, I just want to be happy. I just want to be happy. I want you to know I want you to be happy. I said that all last week. You can go online and watch that sermon from last week. I want you to be happy. But what I really want for you, I want joy for you. Because happiness is circumstantial. Happiness takes place out here. You know, somebody gives you something and you like that and get. And by the way, the shirt I'm wearing, I didn't even buy. Somebody gave me their shirt after they wore it for a few years and said, hey, maybe you could use this. And I'm like, that's so cool. And look at it. It actually looks kind of new. I mean, I had to sew it up a couple times, put a couple buttons on it, and I'm just kidding. It's a really, really, really nice shirt. So my point is this. Circumstantial doesn't bring joy. What we learned last week was the promise that we want, the joy that we want, the joy does not come from probability of circumstances. It comes from the promises of God. Think about this. If you in your right mind would say this, and I've had people say this, well, if I just had a little more better things happen outside, I'd be all right. So let's just say you had 51% of the things in 2021 take place that were positive, and 49 were negative. Would you have joy? No, because outside circumstances are just happiness. But I will tell you this, what takes place, because the promises of God promised us that Jesus Christ would be born. If you receive Jesus Christ as your Lord and personal Savior, you can have joy inside. See, when joy gets in you and when joy happens in you, it says the writer says, joy unspeakable and full of glory. When you have joy inside, it changes your circumstances. It changes your perception and perception of all of what's outside. You look at it different with a different perspective. I want you to understand, it's not all roses. But when you have the joy of the Lord in your heart, circumstances outside seem to be a little more, what? Pleasurable, happiness. So if you have joy, you can have happiness. But if you have happiness, you can't have joy. You can have happiness if you have Jesus. But if you just think you're going to do it without Jesus and have happiness, you'll never experience what true joy is. Does that make sense? So what we learned about the joy of Christmas is, it is the promise of Christmas. That the joy that we want does not come from the probability of circumstances, but comes from the promises of God's word. And so what we want for you today and what I desire for you is real joy. So today what we're going to look at is the joy of impact. The joy of impact. Now, the first one, the joy of promises. Now, the joy of impact is this. What we're going to do is we're going to look at the joy of impact because there's something about Christmas that I'm going to share with you today that I believe you'll relate to. Because you see, it's not all about me. It really isn't all about you. It really is all about Jesus Christ, but it's about those that are outside this building. So would you just bow your heads and pray with me for just a moment? Pray for me as I'll pray for you. Lord, I'm asking in a way like we've never experienced before, that we would see Jesus Christ high and lifted up, that you would speak to the individuals that are in this room or watching online or watching later down the road. I pray that you would meet them at their greatest need. I pray that they would experience real joy today, the real joy of Christmas, that the promises of God delivers real joy. But Lord, today, can we see what the joy of impact is? So speak to our hearts. We're listening. We need you. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. All right, so here's the deal. Christmas is almost here. By the way, I don't know if you know this, but Christmas is only what, like 10 days away. And here's what I want you to think about. Just for a moment, what was the greatest gift you ever received? The greatest gift you ever received. Perhaps it was a childhood memory. When you walked out and you're like, whoa, how did that happen? All those presents are there. Who in the world got those for us? I read a little article this week where a young boy was like, you know, I don't believe in Santa Claus. Well, they went and actually went to this place and they actually were going there and here's Santa. He's thin and there's like, that can't be Santa. he's too slim and all that stuff. Until he sat on his lap, lo and behold, Santa gave him a gift, and it actually had his name on it. So from then on, he was like, oh, man, it's got to be Santa Claus, because how would he know my name? You know, it's just stuff like that that happens in our life. But go back in time. But maybe, ladies, maybe it was a gift you got last year from your husband, or maybe it's a gift, guys, you got from your wife last year. So maybe it's real close. So I got to tell you this. I was thinking about my greatest gift of all. I'm 57 years old, and I'm telling you, I've had a tremendous amount of blessings in my life. But how many people remember 1976? Raise your hand real high. Now, it's real hard for people that remember 1976 because arthritis and, you know, stuff like that. How many people weren't even born 1976? Look, more than that. See, I'm out of my league. I'm telling you what, they're like, we got to get a younger pastor. That dude's old, man. I mean, he's like going to kick the bucket. I'm going to ask James, pop on the screen. This was my Christmas gift, 1976. Dude, I was like, oh my gosh, it was the greatest gift ever. You're saying, why was that so good? I'm telling you what, how could anybody not like the Tyco Racing with curve huggers? I'm telling you what, when I opened that gift, I'm telling you today, my dad was grinning bigger than I was. Exciting, lighted, HO scale racing on over, listen to this, 54 running feet of racing track. It was amazing. Look at some of these things. Includes lane changer. If you never raced anybody in your life, I'm telling you, you know what their biggest complaint was? Well, you beat me because you had the inside lane. Yeah? Come ride me on this one, man. Race me on this one. Why? You got to change lanes, and then you get to run on the track. See, it evens the playing field. Everybody runs the same 54 feet, buddy, and that's why I still beat you. So my point is, look at this. High banking curves, a lap counter. We used to have these guys. Paul Bickler was a cheater, man. He was my buddy next door, and he used to, I beat you, I laughed you. Don't you remember I laughed you? No, the lap counter said I won. Now, I'm just kidding. Paul Bigler and I, here's the deal. We both had similar racetracks like this. I'd box all my stuff up, take it over to his house, and his living room was as big as this. We had like hundreds of feet. We'd be way down here, and you couldn't even hardly see that little teeny car way down there. So that was my experience. I don't know about your experience, but maybe you got something that way. But here's the key. Here's the deal. That was awesome. But I want to bring us back a little bit, and I know you're not going to like this, but we're living in this year. This year's been a little different, right? It's been a little bit different. I don't know about you, but this year's been a little bit different with me. Man, we've been facing a lot of negativity, people, you know, all these things going on. But I'm telling you what, I believe Heritage Church believes people want normalcy. People want a little bit of what? Some of you have sacrificed so much. I cannot tell you. I watched tears roll down grandfather's eyes and grandmother's eyes because why? They couldn't even go and be with their grandkids for a while. We've been so isolated. We're designed for this. We're designed to be together. And we've been so isolated. Some of you lost income. Now, some of you are so busy, you can't keep up with all the work. So I get that. There's pros and cons in the whole thing. But still, let's just be honest. Some of our good friends lost their jobs. Some people don't know what's going on. So people want some normalcy. And so here's the deal. Can we just be honest? I'm going to be honest with you. Don't you get the feeling sometimes that you just start to get inward and you're starting to think, gosh, I just want some normalcy. And you know what? I want to be happy. I just want one more big deal, so to speak, to happen, a big thing. Man, I'm hoping. I don't even know all the plans yet. We're trying to work them out. I'd like to be able to wake up Christmas morning, obviously, with the kids that are still at the household and enjoy a Christmas. But what about getting with family members that afternoon? Are you going to do that? Man, I'm like, gosh, that's what I want. I want something big. I want something normal. I don't want all of this bad news anymore. I don't want to revisit that. I want something normal. What we want is we are people that start to internalize some things and begin to think that, well, I want something. I want something, but here's the deal. If I begin to internalize and say, you know what, I want some happiness in my life, and I want this, Can I just say this? That's the complete opposite of the real true message of Christmas. It's opposite. It's completely opposite. Because when I think about that, I think about this. The last place that Tom Blount needs to be, the last place that you need to be, is in a mindset, this is about me. Because I'm on the area that I shouldn't be. Because here's the thing. The joy of Christmas comes when we impact others with the message of Christmas. If I make it about me because I want to get something and I need this and I need that, I'm going to miss out on the true meaning of Christmas. I'm going to miss out on what I could end up receiving as a benefit, so to speak, of what I did. Because the joy of Christmas comes when we together impact other people's lives with the true meaning of Christmas. That's what I want to look at today. I believe that you and I will understand that the first Christmas was rooted in giving, not getting. The first Christmas that brought true joy to people is in giving, not getting. The best way that you and I in this holiday season can experience real joy is to try to take a breath, try to step back, and I understand there's a lot going on in your life, but just step back and say, God, who is it that I can impact for your glory? God, who is it that I can absolutely go out of my way to make sure they know that the true meaning of Christmas is about giving, impacting other people's lives, investing in other people's lives, inviting them to come to a heritage service. Because I believe with all my heart, if you'll follow along with me in just a moment, what we're going to see is a guy by the name of John the Baptist in the Word of God that was a man used by God. And you're going to find he was just like you and I. Because here's the thing, before I read about his story, do you realize that before you were ever born, that God knew you and he knew your name? He says in the Word of God that you are wonderfully and fearfully made, that you are an unbelievable creation by a loving God. And that sometimes I believe we have a problem when we come to church is that we kind of associate ourselves and compare ourselves to some of the great men and women of the Bible. That's not what he wants you to do. Do you realize that what we see in the Bible are men and women who learn to cooperate with God's leadership in their life, learn to respond to God's initiative in their life? What they did was they were accountable individuals showing up and doing all that they could do, not in their own strength, but understanding that what God does in us, through us, and with us is all God, is that we're accountable to show up and that he's responsible for the outcome. And John the Baptist was one that absolutely was heralding and saying things such, he would say, the Savior is born. John the Baptist was that one. John the Baptist also was the one that says the Messiah, the one that is promised by God, the Messiah that we looked at last week. And the promise of Christmas is this, is what we find is he says the Messiah is coming. John also was the one that says, behold, behold the Lamb of God that taketh away the sins of the world. This guy believed in his heart. He was born, obviously, to live for God. He was bought with a price. Therefore, he didn't glorify himself. It wasn't about himself. It was about other people. And he began to proclaim that Jesus Christ would come. And so we pick up in John's Gospel, chapter 3, and I want you to see something, and I hope to give you just enough so that you can take from here and remember the greatest joy you will ever experience is impacting other people's lives with the real true meaning of Christmas. It says here in John chapter 3, he, that would be Jesus he's speaking of, must become greater and greater, and I must become less and less. He has come from above and is greater than anyone else. We are on the earth and we speak of earthly things. Us that are on the earth speak of earthly things. But he, that would be Jesus, he has come from heaven. This was the one that John said, you know, the Messiah will come, the long-awaited Savior. So he has come from heaven and is greater than anyone else. He testifies about what he has seen and heard, but how few believe what he tells them. Isn't that amazing? And we experience that. How few people around us, and I wonder why they don't believe. Maybe it's because the way I live my life. Maybe it's the way Tom Blount lives his life and how he responds and acts. So people don't always believe in what we tell them. But anyways, he goes on and he says, and anyone who accepts his testimony can affirm what? That God is true. And listen to what he says. Who sent him? For he is sent by God. He wasn't sent by man. He was sent by God. He speaks God's words, for God gives him the Spirit without limit. And the Father loves his Son and has put everything into his hands. Now listen to this. This is so key. You do not want to miss this. And anyone, that would be you, anyone, he says right here, who believes in God's Son has eternal life. John 3:16 prior to this breaks it down and says, for God so loved the world. That's key. God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever, that's you, anybody listening after, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish but have everlasting life. Do you realize that's the true meaning of Christmas? That's why Jesus came. Jesus came to this earth to fix the sin problem. Way back in the Garden of Eden, when Adam and Eve had sinned, it entered into the entire human race. And without Christ, I would have died and been separated from God for eternity. He said, Pastor Tom, I don't know what you're talking about. I'm not even a follower of Jesus. Listen, if religion has pushed you away, thank you for coming. The legalistic mindset of preachers for years have pushed people away and telling them what to do. Listen, you can't do anything except Jesus Christ does it in you, through you, and with you. We preach these things that you got to live at this level, but in reality, we're down here. I'm not saying it's okay, but somewhere in the midst, there's this tension. People walk from church many times feeling guilty, condemned, and just going away thinking, man, I can't live it that way. You can't, but God can. He loved you so much that he sent his only begotten Son, Jesus, to go into the world and to live a sinless life. The message of Christmas is Jesus Christ giving us eternity and fixing the sin problem. Now, I want you to think about the mindset of John. It amazes me. John is so humble. But be careful. It's not like you can just flip a switch and be humble. Do you realize that you need to trust Jesus to be humble? John was so humble and he said, I must decrease, but he must increase. John realized that a call upon his life was that, as Paul said to the church at Rome, Corinth, he said, we are bought with a price, that we should glorify God, that we are not our own. So you see, John knew that. John knew that he was not his own, so he followed Jesus Christ. And so what we realize is what John is doing is living out what God designed for him. That's what I want for you. I want you to live out what God has designed for you. I want you to be able to understand that God has called you in the same way he called John. We must decrease. He must increase. John's life was making an impact. But let's go back a few years before John was doing this. And Luke says this, but the angel said, don't be afraid, Zechariah. God has heard your prayer. Your wife, Elizabeth, will give you a son, and you are to name him John. The name John means the Lord is gracious. The Lord is gracious. And by the way, God is gracious. Yes, he hates sin, but he loves the sinner, and he loves the sinner so much he gave his son. But the Lord is gracious. That's what John's name meant. And so he says, you have a great joy and gladness. You're going to name your son John, and you will have great joy and gladness, and many will rejoice at his birth, for he will be great in the eyes of the Lord. He must never touch wine or other alcoholic drinks. It might have been part of the old Nazarite vow from the Old Testament. We're not real clear here, but nonetheless, he's not going to do that. He will be filled with the Holy Spirit. First time mention of the Holy Spirit in Luke's gospel. First time mention. Even before his birth. That's crazy. And so he says, and he will turn many Israelites to the Lord their God. He will be a man with the spirit of power like Elijah. He will prepare people for the coming of the Lord. He's like Elijah was, where he is encouraging people to turn away from their sin and turn to a holy God. And that's what John's doing here. And so he will turn their hearts of the fathers into their children, and he will cause those who are rebellious to accept the wisdom of the godly. John was impacting people's lives. John was inviting people in his day and era to come and hear, come and see. Can I ask you a question? What about you? Could you not invite one person? I do my best to try to invite people to church all the time. And I want you to know, all you got to do is just tell them, hey, man, just come check it out. I told the first service, because of that little smoke up there, I mean, you could just tell them, hey, man, come to our church. We have fires in our church. You know, I mean, people might not come then. You know, some people are like, oh, I can't enter church. You know, the walls will fall down on me, you know. Well, we have hard hats at the door, right? So it's not a big deal. So my point is, I bet you could invite somebody. You could invite somebody to church because it's an amazing thing. And as you heard Dinah actually talk about it, we have 7 services online. You could have a watch party. You could have a watch party at home before church service, at here or after. 7 services, 3, I think, on Saturday and 4 on Sunday or something like that at Heritage Church, Sterling Heights. We have 1 here at our place here at 5:30, and then 1 at 9:30 and 11 o'clock on Sunday. But here's the thing I want you to understand. The best way that we could all experience joy is impact somebody else's life by what? Inviting them. I want you to think about this. Many of you people that have been associated with Heritage Church for 7 years, you can attest to this. I can attest to this. I've been all over. I've been the privilege to speak multiple times at the main campus, but it's this. Hundreds of people can actually testify and say, hey, somebody just invited me to Heritage Church. Somebody just said, hey, come on out. I just spoke to a lady in the main area there after the main church and was introduced to her. And she said, I watched you online, because the gal standing right next to her introduced me to her, said, hey, just get online and watch it. She watched me online and then came here. She'd been coming for 3 weeks. All because somebody said, hey, check it out. And I know what some people say about me. They say, hey, you got to check out my preacher, man. He's a lunatic. A lot of them do that. They say, he's nuts. He just doesn't have it together. You got to come see what he says, because it doesn't make sense at all. But I want you to understand, personally, you and I can be impacting and inviting people. But I want to be personal with you. I can honestly tell you, as a young man married, I didn't invite somebody. And I knew him for a long time. I grew up coming up here to Imlay City ever since I was a kid. My mom and dad would drive up here. My uncle then bought a house on Clear Lake Road. So we would go out on Clear Lake Road, and we became friends with the family that we'd come up here. We hunted with, we fished with, we rode motorcycles with, we camped with, we did all kinds of stuff. I knew this guy. He's like a brother. Never once did I tell him about Jesus. He knew I was a preacher's kid. But I don't get it. Because you see, I'm not saved because my dad was a preacher. I'm saved because I told Jesus one day, Lord, I know I'm a sinner. I need you to save me, come into my heart and save me. Something like that, just something. I repented. I never invited this guy. Knew him for years. He was married, had kids, until one day I got a call from my cousin Kenny Brown. And he told me the guy's name, and I'm not going to say it, but he said, hey, I just want to let you know, so-and-so had a tragic accident late last night and is dead. You know what I look at that as? A missed opportunity. I don't want you to miss an opportunity. I know I'll still probably miss opportunities. But man, every chance I get, when I think God opens a door, I just try to invite people to come check out Heritage Church. But I want to tell you something, honestly, and I want you to watch something. Somebody at Heritage Church, a few years back before this campus was even started, had somebody in their life that cared enough about Tom Greer. And somebody, all he said was, come check it out. And I want you to listen to what Tom Greer says, because I believe you know a Tom Greer in your life that you could have check it out.
It was the summer of 2011. We were in a spot where we were rebuilding our spiritual life at the time. So we knew that we wanted, when we got married, we knew we wanted to have a home church in place before we had kids. We got married in 03 and we said home church in place before kids. So we got connected with a church, a local church in the community, and we loved it, had a lot of fun there. We felt over time we were missing out on opportunities. So we started searching. And my friend Leo invited me to Heritage, said, you should come check it out. And I'll never forget that first meeting. So we come summer of 11, and I'm across the room. I just hear, you know, I yell, Tom Greer, just from across the big room. And I just stopped and froze, and I hadn't seen Leo in a few years. So it was nice to catch up with him and connect and thank him for inviting us. We loved the service, loved enjoyed the message, enjoyed Pastor Jeff. I actually intended it on not coming back, and communicated that with Pastor Jeff. I actually sent him an email saying, thank you for hosting us, but we're looking for a place where we can actually grow spiritually, so we won't be coming back. can't believe I sent that, but whatever, I did. And knowing how busy church staff and pastors are, I never would have thought that we would have gotten a response back from that email. Sure enough, Pastor Jeff responded to the email, asked us to sit down and just chat with me about things. And he laid out the purpose of Heritage Church, the importance of the 101 class, and the importance of connecting and growth groups and serving. And really, through that meeting, I felt that, this is gonna be our home. I would not have come to Heritage if I wasn't invited. There's tons of churches in town. I don't know if this one would have made the list. If we probably would have found someplace else or stopped looking and stayed where we were unless we were invited. And all Leo did was just say, come check it out. That's all he had to say. And when I've been inviting people in the time that I've been here, I try to do the exact same thing. There's so much I want to say, but just come check it out. Just come see it and, let the Lord do the rest. So I'm very thankful that Leo invited us, and this is home.
So, I don't know your background, but most people know my background. I come from a very conservative, fundamental background, and that's great. I've never apologized for that. I am so proud that my mom and dad raised me in a good Christian home, and my dad was a powerful, powerful Baptist preacher. And I get it. Some of you think, well, Heritage isn't for me. You do it different. And we do it different. I never dreamed I would be at a church like this. But when I found out the heart of the church and the heart of Pastor Jeff and the heart of the staff and the arts and worship, all we try to do is capture people's hearts long enough. Just get their attention long enough. Captivate their attention long enough. Capture that long enough to do what? Introduce them to Jesus Christ. So we want to make sure that people are engaged in a service to where we can capture their attention long enough to capture their hearts for Christ, and then do what? Train them to serve them. That's why class is 101, 201, 301, 401. Why? We want to make disciples, followers of Jesus Christ, because I want you to understand, we want to reach the community, but the world beyond. God didn't just say it's for our community. We have to go to all the world. All the ends of the world. But here's the thing. I want you to experience true joy. And I want to remind you, your true joy is not going to come from the probability of your circumstances. It's going to come from the promises of God. But the only way you're going to experience from that promise of God is this. The joy of Christmas comes when we impact what? Other people's lives with what? The message of Christmas. That's what we want. We want to impact one person at a time with the message of the gospel of Jesus Christ, and then do what? Train them to serve him and do it over and over again. And so would you bow your heads with me this morning, and let's close in prayer. Father in heaven, thank you so much for allowing us to come into this place freely. But Lord, the words of my mouth and the meditations of my heart are all to please you and you alone. And so I'm asking that you would not allow the word to return void from what was spoken here today. Thank you for meeting with us. Thank you for loving us. But Lord, right now, with every head bowed and every eye closed, I'm asking, Lord, you're the one who saved. I'm asking if there's a young boy or girl here today or an elderly man or an elderly woman or anybody in between that is not 100% sure that heaven would be their home, that they would get saved today. So, Lord, perhaps if they're listening online or here personally, would you save them? Lord, may that person, if they want to receive Christ right now, simply cry out to the Lord and say, Jesus, I know I'm a sinner. I believe you died upon the cross to save me from my sins. Come into my heart and save me. And Lord, may they just thank you for saving them. So Lord, thank you for meeting with us today. Thank you for saving those people today. We love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. If you'd look